several cross-channel experiences. And we have two presenters, Zach Paradis and Jared Worley. Zach is an innovation strategist, professor, and author obsessed with transforming lives through the customer experience. He leads the experience innovation group at SapientNitro, teaches at the ITT Institute of Design, and lives in Chicago. And Jared heads up strategic partnerships at Gigya, where he helps leading brands tie social and behavioral data into marketing platforms and to improve campaign performance and conversion. So just a few logistics to cover before we get started. Zach and Jared will talk for about 45 minutes, and then we'll have some time at the end for audience questions. At any time, please feel free to send your questions through the chat window in the GoToWebinar, and we'll address them at the end of the session. And just to note, this webinar will be recorded, and we will follow up with a link to the recorded version via email. And with that, I'll hand it over to Zach to get started.
Thanks so much. Hey, Zach, good day.
You're good.
Thanks so much. Thanks everyone for joining the webinar today. Definitely excited to be sharing thoughts on secrets to creating memorable cross-channel experiences. I would, one note on the title, I think that memorable experiences, by that we mean long-lasting and positive experiences, and one that are really effective in terms of creating relationships between people and brands. As Kevin noted, my name is Zachary Paradis. I'm the Director of Innovation Strategy. I'm obsessed with the topic of basically customer experience and creating value for people through new experience. As was mentioned, I'm lead of Experience Innovation, a group that's really focused on evangelizing the future of experience and how it can transform the relationship between people and brands. It's a global group on the company, and we're really looking at what's next. The whole company is obviously focused on innovation, but the group that I lead happens to try to be a little ahead of the game. I write and teach on the topic, and wrote a book called NakedInnovation.com. So it's definitely more than just my job. It's sort of my life. In terms of my company, SapientNitro, the global leader in marketing, design, and technology, really a new breed of agency. We like to say that we are recognized by other people. It's not us who say we're leaders. Companies like Gartner and so on and so forth put us in the upper right, the top right category and position maps in terms of great companies, and we're proud to kind of be in that position. So that's enough on introductions. Obviously, the topic today is about cross-channel experiences, and I think that one of the things that's really important to recognize that today it's sort of common wisdom that the quote-unquote experience matters. And that wasn't necessarily true in the past, but a lot of data we have supports the notion that customer experience is radically important. The chart on the screen now is actually put together by Watermark Consulting using data from Forrester, the research firm's CXI survey, where they look at basically the customer experience of different companies and then categorize them as leaders, as average, as laggards, and so on and so forth. And Watermark went ahead and took their data and looked at what the company's stock market's performance, and lo and behold, what did they find? They found that the quote-unquote leaders, as described by Forrester, were in fact also leaders in terms of business performance, stock market performance. So we sort of know that it matters is because we go into stores and there's that sort of Apple effect with people having higher expectations, but we're really seeing it in terms of the market as well. And in fact, if you actually ask leaders of global companies, the kind of the Fortune 1000 and beyond, Bain asked them in a Closing the Delivery Gap study, interviewed 362 firms, interviewed the C-suite, and asked them what was important to them. And 95% of firms, leaders in these firms, actually said that they were customer-focused and that it was really critical. And 80% of those same people actually said they thought they delivered a superior experience to customers. Which is actually really interesting, because the most important statistic of the three is actually this, which is 8%, which is the number of how many customers in the same companies that were where they interviewed leaders. Only 8% agreed that those same companies delivered a superior experience. So we're looking at this massive gap where 80% of these leaders thought they were doing a great job, delivering a great experience, creating memorable cross-channel experiences, but their actual customers, only 8% of them did. So how is it possible that we have this incredible gap? Well, we have it because we've really been tackling the notion of experience in kind of just incorrect ways. And so we have to really focus on addressing the gap in a couple different ways. One is we want to shift focus, and I'll share what I mean by that as well. And the second is we need to really alter our approach in terms of how we tackle creating new products and services. So and communication. So let me kind of jump into shifting focus and kind of unpack that a little bit. We've built the corporate world on this classic funnel of marketing and commerce. And, you know, people might have one or two different names for one of these phases, but at the end of the day, the classic sales funnel has essentially been one of the largest drivers for how companies organize and how communications products and services are created today. They're well-worn, and it's really at this point been kind of pummeled into us through business school, through corporate kind of writing, and so on and so forth. And we really thought it was the pinnacle of commerce and capitalism. But what it really is, and what we're going to see, is that it's actually really a 20th century artifact. The classic sales funnel had its use for that was tremendously valuable for about 50 or 60 years, and we're really moving to a new place. And one of the things that you see as you kind of dive into this, and there's an interesting study done by Brandon Schauer called Serious Service Anticipation Gap. When you look at the services space, so things like financial services, telecom, restaurants, travel and tourism, so on and so forth, if you look at that, there's $40 billion spent in ad spends for the top five service categories, those industries, right? And then in the same spaces, there's something like $2 billion invested in the planning and the design of those same services. So for every 20 bucks spent on ads for services in the U.S., about a dollar is spent on improving that service. That is a pretty remarkable figure and a ratio that is frankly just completely out of whack and really has set the table for disaster. What it means is we're really effectively very good and spend a ton of money to set very high expectations for prospects and customers, and then we push them through what are quite possibly very shitty services and products. So we really have to ask ourselves the question, why would we ever do this? And in fact, one of the kind of big secrets in terms of that we have to kind of look really hard at is there's a lot of value being destroyed by traditional marketing. And the reason is because when you drive awareness and customer expectations and you do not pay off those expectations with compelling services and products, you're actually creating brand deficit rather than brand equity. So people who like to use marketing in the traditional sense to drive value through equity in the brand, the reality is if you drive expectations and do not deliver on them in services and products, you've failed. You've actually destroyed value and you've created a deficit. So we really have to look hard at our spend in terms of kind of pure awareness and sort of lead generation without paying it off with tremendous services and products. So we really need to look hard at our budgets, and we need to shift dollars where appropriate to make sure that we're not pushing people to things that will actually make us dislike our brand and destroy value. So that's a really critical thing. I mean, this is especially important as industries, has matured and connected media like the web, Google, and mobile devices, they've enabled us to more easily interact directly with customers. And of course, we want great service in addition to great traditional marketing communications to pull through the people to our products and to kind of develop deep relationships. And you know, what this is not is this. And some colleagues in our companies might believe that it's a media problem. And it just isn't the case. The reality is that a lot of the, you know, certainly the biggest companies in the world, they don't have awareness problems. They have troubles dealing with superlative service. That's what they have problems with. So, you know, I think it's sort of a funny cartoon here with the sharp razor teeth, in the lower funnel and really where obviously where people will be connecting to your service. But I don't want to also make this seem like it's about strictly reshaping the funnel because in reality the funnel has completely exploded. And I think you'll see a lot of charts from different companies where, you know, people say this, the customer is in the center. And we would actually dismiss that notion that the customer is, quote unquote, in the center. The customer is in the center of their own lives, sure, but it is not necessarily, you know, in the center. If we look at it as it's in the center of our own company, one of the problems with that is we only look at our own touch points. We only look at the things that we control. And so what I mean by the funnel has exploded is that we learn about products and services through so many touch points that brands do not control of those same very products and services. We have to push out much more broadly, and we also have to recognize that it's not just a sales journey within an ecosystem that we know, and that matters. There's actually many journeys that matter, and we need to embrace the fact that there's many, many journeys within that. And interestingly enough, McKinsey, writing for Harvard Business Review late this past year, has a really great piece called The Truth About Customer Experience, and I'd implore you to read the piece. Where they actually do a lot of research into exactly how the best companies are actually performing and creating superlative customer experience. And what they find is it's this key thing where it's not just a single funnel, it's many journeys. And that's the key thing. It's not journey, it's journeys. And I think one of the challenges that we're seeing on a regular basis is we're seeing people take a sales funnel and slap the name journey on it and then essentially say, oh, look, we're customer focused. That is not customer focused. You are not going to get the superlative customer experience by taking a classic old school traditional marketing model, you know, changing the name of it and sort of slightly changing the content and then you're done. I mean, that is not going to cut it. So the reality is we really have to push ourselves to recognize that, you know, kind of the single journey, actually there's one journey that might get you directly to purchase that goes through some owned and some, you know, unowned touch points. But there's other journeys as well. And all those journeys will contribute to the engagement and the relationship that a person can have with a brand and with a company. And the reality is recognizing these different many journeys, all of a sudden it offers up a lot more opportunity for companies and for brands to actually provide tremendous experiences and to provide new value that they can get paid for or that can sort of redouble the value that they deliver and make yet another reason why you should be choosing that brand in terms of their primary product and services. And so this is fine, right, in terms of theory, but what does this actually look like? Well, let me show you what I mean. So we do some work with Royal Bank of Scotland in the UK. This is a very large organization. You know, it's founded in 1727. They have over 140,000 global employees, the third largest bank in the UK by market value. They are a very big, very complex organization. And when we started our work with them, you could absolutely have taken the kind of sales funnel, the apply for a current account, a standard retail banking account, and of course we need to look at that, and of course we need to optimize it. But that is not it. If that was it, it wouldn't be enough. It's also about looking at use and management of a retail and a current account. It's the whole just the story around saving and how challenging it is to save and for people to save in their lives. And looking at that as a separate thing that is incredibly valuable that RBS could help with. Obviously, home buying is a critical story for all of us in our lives and a pattern that you can have with the bank where there's a lot of opportunity for the bank to add additional kind of value and services. And private banking, and the reality is you could have even more, but these are kind of the core journeys that we identified. And for every single one, we exploded them through primary research, secondary research, really getting deep into in a totally cross-channel way where the bank is really delivering superlative experience today and where it needs to deliver superlative experience tomorrow. And again, so not reducing it to a single journey, which is a funnel, and then all of a sudden sort of unpacking all of these patterns that we can have with customers just reveal tremendous opportunities. And let me show you specifically what I mean. So RBS is known for as helpful banking, and that's sort of their organizing idea. So partially it's a communication platform, but it's also how the bank operates, how the bank works. And through storyscaping, which I'll talk about in a second, and good experience design, we took the process of current account use, and we created this product, a mobile product called Get Cash. And it's a simple product, actually, but it came directly out of looking at current account usage, essentially your standard kind of bank account, and looking for problems that RBS customers were having. And one of them that they were having is this. Sometimes people in their lives would have issues where they didn't have their wallet or they didn't have a bank account, and as an account holder, you wanted to give them money, and you weren't there in person. So you had this problem where there was no way to actually get maybe a daughter who had lost her wallet and so was in another town and had no money, or maybe a builder or a contractor who did a little work for you and you needed to pay them a couple $100 and weren't able to actually be there in person to pay them. What Get Cash does is this. You submit a financial amount, a dollar amount. It's actually in pounds because it's British. You submit an amount, and you basically say, I want to get a Get Cash code. You get the code, which you actually see here on the screen. That code is then sent to the person that you would like to send the money to, just by text or whatever means you would like, email, what have you. You could call the person and give them the code if you wanted to. That person then goes to any RBS or NatWest ATM, goes up to the ATM, types the code in, and gets the cash. It is that simple. There's really no reason in the world why every bank shouldn't be doing this. But the reality is this. If you focus on a funnel which is getting people to buy a bank account, you will never come up with this concept. You will never come up with this new kind of value. So you need to, again, explode what are the patterns, just not the single pattern that you have with customers, and then look for how you can add value. This now has actually become a major selling point in the marketing and the classic sales funnel of actually getting accounts. This is actually a big deal for them because it actually pays off the notion that they're a helpful bank. We're super proud of the work. It's won a Cannes Lion. gold this last year. It's had tremendous success in the market. We're talking about 20,000 plus get cash requests a week and growing very quickly. Many tens of millions of pounds get cash requests, and it's just really galvanized the business in terms of how they could look for new ways to be helpful outside of just the classic funnel, and then leverage that in the context of marketing and creating memorable experiences that really drive fantastic relationships. So now let's kind of also in looking at this gap, let's look at altering our approach. So if we shift our focus from, you know, early funnel, you know, really awareness generation, and we shift it towards service, and then we explode the single funnel into many journeys that are actually all opportunities for us to create value and memorable cross-channel experiences. How do we actually do it in terms of creating the product and service? So one way is having the multiple journeys, right, which I've already shared. Two other ways that I would say are important are storyscaping and blending spaces. Storyscaping is actually a SapientNitro approach, but at the same time, you know, sharing, I'll share with you the kind of principles of it, and there's no reason that you couldn't start to use those principles yourself. It all keys on this notion that as marketers, or as people, frankly, we leverage stories to change attitudes and drive behavior, right? I mean, that's a pretty, everyone should agree that stories are critical to how humans make meaning, and that stories, both the stories we tell about our own lives, I had a bad experience at the store today, oh, you can't imagine how great these customer service people were. They, you know, they blew my mind. These stories in our lives are really important, and we leverage stories to communicate value to potential prospects and to customers. The problem is that to date, you know, rather than storytelling, we really have been in a very unidirectional fashion, largely because of the platforms that we had available to us, and because it was the model that worked. It really was about yelling, and it really was about trying to get your message out in a shotgun style approach. And let's face it, the world has absolutely changed with the whole opportunities of interactive platforms, and even the traditional platforms moving to a place where they're interactive. We're really moving to a place where, you know, we, the people, we're not satisfied with being told a story. We want to be part of it. We expect that we are the center of, you know, the interaction, and that we really want to have an impact. We want to be able to really, you know, to tangibly be part of it and be recognized. So as brands and as companies, we have to learn how to create worlds, not just these isolated ads or campaigns on the side, or not just isolated products or services on the other side. We need to see how can we connect the dots between all of these different touch points that we create. We do that through a process we call storyscaping. And it's about creating this landscape of engagement and experience where people can interact in a very meaningful way. By meaningful, I mean by a common pattern of stories, via every touch point, which enables a brand to become part of a person's story. And those are the stories that matter, people, not brands. A brand story has resonance because we tap into the stories of people and to the things that matter to them. And for us, that is about creating an organizing idea, and then leveraging an engagement platform, so interactive platforms that allow us to meet people where they are and to personalize experience, and those deliver optimized journeys, those things that we talked about before. So that's really, really a critical thing in terms of looking at the world holistically and recognizing that marketing and product they may have been different departments before, and they may have been years separated or thousands of miles separated in the past. But now the reality is this experience is the sum of communications products and services. And so if you're going to really deliver a brand that exceeds expectations, you're going to have to start to look in a more holistic way. And we think storyscaping is a great platform for doing that. Another thing that we're going to have to do is we're going to have to blend spaces like never before. Treating the physical and digital as different is really something we only do as professionals because we have to manage it. So we would have a retail group, and we would have a digital group, and we would have a product group, and this is the thing. As people, we don't care. When we pick up our phones in the morning after rolling out of bed, we don't say, oh, I'm going to pick my smart mobile device up and I'm going to access Facebook and, see what my social network is doing. We don't do that. We just pick up our phone and we say, hey, we're going to see what's going on with our friends. We don't see the disparate barrier or the distance between physical and digital as people. We see them as managers in companies because they're areas that we have to own. And the challenge for all of us now, and a big secret, is if you're not tackling how to blend digital, physical, and emotional space in real time and space, then you're going to lose ground to the companies and to the people who are. If you look at this picture of this woman standing in an aisle, she's looking at a pill bottle in a retail store using a smart mobile device. Is this experience and is this touch point a retail experience, a product experience, a service experience, a digital experience? It's all of those things collapsed into one picture. And oh, by the way, it's not a millennial. It's, it's someone who we don't necessarily always consider as that. So we need to blend these things, and we need to achieve kind of emotional resonance by connecting the dots and blending what were traditionally seen as separate into integrated wholes. And one of the things that is really important, and many people who are in marketing didn't get into marketing because they love technology necessarily, is all of these touch points are powered by technology. And if they aren't right now, they will tomorrow. The reality is it doesn't matter if you're talking to a person in the store. That person is empowered by the technology platforms that sit behind them. So we've moved to this space where everything in our lives is powered by technology in some way. And this isn't something that, again, people in marketing got into marketing because they love technology necessarily. They did it because maybe they loved creative or they loved to, kind of the business aspect of it or what have you. The reality of the situation is if you're not to be good in those areas, you have to be good at technology too. Every company will be a technology company moving forward. You look at, and it's a very diverse suite of technology that we have to consider across commerce, social, content management, customer management, what have you. And obviously a company like Gigya and their service suite is kind of designed specifically to address a part of this tremendous complexity that we have to really deal with. But the goal, obviously, is not to focus on the technology, but to be good at it so that we can enable relationships so that the interactions that we're having directly with customers or through other touch points we don't own can result in buying in some ways, but also in just in increased value in engagement. So just going to share kind of one more little case and then a final thought and pass it over. In the context of thinking about this in terms of blending space and leveraging organizing ideas, X Games is one where we've had some fun work that kind of really kind of illustrates this. X Games as a franchise is obviously a growing franchise for ESPN. The whole field of games is obviously growing, increasingly a big deal. And X Games came to us with, you know, the desire to reboot the end-to-end experience of what, you know, X Games is about. And you know, and we looked at it in terms of how can we deliver activating awesome everywhere. And if there's something that's really important to X Games and the fan of the X Games, it's stuff that's awesome. It's the awesome trick. And you know, it's sort of this radical feeling you get when you see someone do something incredible in kind of these kind of performance kind of games. And we looked across, okay, well, you know, again, just as we said before, it's not about a single funnel, but it's actually about recognizing there's many journeys that you have to support. So on the left, you know, you have to support the person who might be sitting on their couch and is kind of just sitting back and is relaxing. On the middle, you might have to support someone in the moment at the actual games themselves. And on the right, you might want to support someone who's kind of having a second screen experience like this. So, you know, a whole notion of second screen, obviously a kind of a relatively talked about notion in the last few years. For the context of the X Games, a natural extension to watching the X Games on TV and sitting with a tablet device in your on your couch, catching up on the games on the desktop and kind of the past games obviously makes tons of sense. But also what's really important is recognizing people at the games, right? And how can you actually leverage being at the games and activate awesome in that way? And we actually came up with a new kind of service for ESPN called the Hype Meter. And the Hype Meter, there's a video on this online if you want to check it out, as well as the RBS example I showed earlier. But the Hype Meter is actually this thing where, regardless of whether you're sitting at your desktop watching on TV with a tablet or there at the games themselves, it's activity on the site and activity in social media and activity supporting the people at the X Games who are playing, who are competing that you love the most. You actually can generate hype, and hype is generated through a collective of everyone who's there, you know, at the games, everyone who's sitting on their desktops and maybe at work and trying to do work and catch up on the games at the same time, or if you're sitting there in front of your TV and using an iPad to kind of support that. And again, it's been tremendously successful. I mean, engagement across the board, every kind of measure you would want in terms of time, video played, uniques, so on and so forth, it's over 100% across the board since we've launched this stuff. The app that we launched on the iTunes Store was number one for quite a long time in the sport area, and again, just the quotes from ESPN themselves, they're just, you know, they're blown away at the numbers and they think it's a huge win. So, and this is the thing, so creating memorable cross-channel experiences is about kind of recognizing, as our former CXO has said famously, the experience is the brand. The experience is all of those touch points that you have with a company. So if you're actually not actively connecting them, if you're actively not kind of addressing the silos you have in the organization, if you're actively not looking at all the patterns, not just the sales pattern, you're actually quite possibly destroying your brand value rather than creating it. And with that, I'd say thank you, and I'll hand it over to my co-presenter.
All right, thanks so much, Zach. I'm going to change the presentation real quick and hand it over to Jared, and he'll get started in 1 second here. All right.
Perfect. Thanks, Kevin. Thank you, Zach. That was an excellent presentation. Thanks, everyone, for joining. You know, I've already had a little bit of an introduction here, but Just to give you a quick intro on Gigya, we've been working with partners like Sapient for quite some time. We're very excited to work together to complete some of these strategies that Zach was alluding to. And, you know, some of the examples you're probably familiar with. We've worked with Sapient on clients from Beats by Dre and MGM Resorts. But what we've seen, and we're very excited about the recent growth over the last 2 years, is a rapid expansion in brands and consumer products, retailers, really trying to utilize technologies like Gigya to improve their understanding of consumers and consumer relationships. And that's really our core focus as a business, is to help brands better connect with their consumers, better understand their behavior, and build one-to-one relationships through digital authentication. And, you know, where Gigya comes into play is really sitting in that digital divide between brands and consumers to facilitate the digital handshake, to activate that and understand that user across channels, not just within the context of a specific brand, but how does that individual interact with other brands, other activities and engagements? What are their likes and interests? Where do they live? Who are they married to? When do they get a new job? All these things that matter to marketers when it comes to personalizing and managing consumer relationships is going to be facilitated through a digital handshake. And for us, that starts with authentication. So Gigya's platform provides an easy way for marketers. I know Zach hit the nail on the head, and not to belittle any marketing technical prowess here, but some of the challenge has been, you know, how do we establish that relationship? How do we build these digital experiences, and how do we capture user information? That's historically been on the table for IT to manage, and not something that marketing typically has been responsible for. But as we find that marketers more and more are responsible for creating the digital experience for their consumers across, there are a lot of technological challenges and hurdles that come up. And so our success as a business has been to provide a marketer-friendly platform to build registration systems, capture user information through social login or native registration in a very friendly format, and providing the back-end architecture, if you will, to actually store and manage that information and make it useful for marketers in terms of activating data, plugging it into their existing marketing platforms. And, you know, one of the approaches we've taken in the market, I think, is really valuable. Zach alluded to this. It's not one piece of technology that solves all the problems. And, when it comes to capturing identity as a key of activating marketing, the challenge is, you know, how do we get users to engage? How do we bring users into that experience and make them part of the story? And that's really going to be driven by your engagement experience. And there's a lot of tools that are out there today that can help you. Our approach has been to tie together social engagement tools, loyalty solutions, things like gamification and commenting, ratings and reviews, plugins that help induce users or incent users to log in, share their information, give you that digital handshake in a permission-based way, and help overall increase conversions and engagement on your site. So the approach for us helps marketers have a single go-to platform rather than having to go to 6, 7, 8 different vendors to build that digital experience. That's one area where I think we've seen a lot of success, but it's also important in improving the end user experience as well. You know, interacting with a single platform, a single source of technology, and having that managed end-to-end, recognizing that user throughout the experience based on their identity. So when they leave a comment on your content or they review one of your products, they have a seamless experience. It's personalized. They're recognized by name. And they can also see what others in the community are doing and how they're interacting with the brand as well. So one of the challenges, I think, when it comes to making this jump into an identity-based marketing strategy and really leveraging consumer identity to power your marketing experiences, you know, how do you capture and manage all of this data effectively? And there are a lot of roadblocks in terms of tying together databases. Zach mentioned, you know, siloed data sources or resources within large organizations that oftentimes don't talk to each other. They're not accessible to various teams or to third-party vendors or other third-party partners. So one of the areas where we're helping our clients is to consolidate that architecture and provide a next-generation identity storage platform or marketing platform, if you will, to consolidate user identity information and first-party customer data so that it can be utilized by marketers. But more importantly, I think it's the ability to scale. You know, social profile data, identity data is a huge amount of information, and managing that can be a challenge. So we've designed our solution to take that into account and provide a way for you to not only manage that today, but scale into the future as there are new sources of information. You know, there's no question that we live in a connected consumer world where the data points don't just come from authentication, but also from the sensor in your tennis shoes when you're running with Nike Plus, or the GPS system in your car, and the thermostat on your wall. And all of these data points can help you as a marketer drive the consumer experience if you're able to tie those to a user identity, manage those effectively, and ultimately port those into your marketing systems of record. Another area where we can help, and I think this is also very important to having the right infrastructure on the back end, should you be able to now manage this information and collect this information effectively through a platform like Gigya, you're unlocking the ability to gain unparalleled insight into your user base and into the customer journey, into the customer interactions with other brands and other experiences beyond just your site or your products. And we see this as a huge opportunity for marketers to optimize their strategy, optimize their business initiatives. So being able to make those correlations between customers who spend a certain amount of money on your site each month and tie that into their favorite television shows or their favorite activities now gives you new opportunities to personalize the marketing experience and personalize communication. And that happens through for Gigya through our ecosystem of partners. So taking these new consumer insights and porting those into platforms like ExactTarget or Salesforce or Rich Relevance to better activate that data unlocks an incredible amount of value for our clients. But it also removes those challenges of trying to buy third-party information, buy third-party data, and collect insights in a whole new way. And this is where we're seeing a huge amount of adoption for large consumer brands that have historically not had that one-to-one relationship with their clients. You know, Red Bull is a great example, someone we've worked with to help remove that retail barrier in understanding consumer interest and behavior. So I did want to just take a quick second. Zach alluded to this earlier about making the consumer part of the experience. And so I wanted to highlight just a quick case study here that we did with Capcom. And they were actually leveraging our gamification platform within a mobile experience to help increase awareness about the launch of a new game. And they saw a huge amount of success by pulling in authenticated users, personalizing the user experience, and even creating an augmented reality experience around the user's profile, user's information. But on top of that, not only did they see great success in terms of sales driven through the app, but also in the data that they were able to capture as a business. And so we're finding that, again, providing the engagement tools to facilitate user engagement, personalize the experience, are not only important to users in terms of improving their experience and making it more engaging, But it's also important for marketers. So you're able to now capture this data and insight on your users in order to drive your marketing initiatives in the future. So I didn't want to spend a whole lot of time talking about Gigya, but that's the 20,000 foot overview. It's Gigya in a nutshell. And just to summarize, we are a connected consumer management platform, and our goal is to work together with partners like Sapient to help every brand better understand their consumers, create more effective customer relationships, and better deal with the challenges of managing customer identity, first-party data in the cloud in order to improve conversions and marketing efficacy in the future. So that's it from my side. I did want to say quickly, if you're coming to South by Southwest, by all means, stop by the Gigya Bar and Grill. If you haven't seen something from marketing, you probably will, but we love to meet people and always happy to buy food and drinks for our friends. So I hope to see you soon.
All right. Thanks, Jared. So now is the time when we're going to open it up to questions. So please, if you have any questions, chat them in through the GoToWebinar panel, and we'll answer as many as possible. Just to quickly get it kicked off here, I have one for Zach, which is, what is the first step a marketer can do to get started?
Okay, first step to get started is a good question. I would actually say, obviously it depends on kind of the level you're talking about, in terms of marketer, but I'd say really examine the patterns of relationships that you have with customers. Like, force yourself to not just look at the classic sales funnel, because the reality is, as Peter Drucker famously said, the name of the game is creating a customer, and it's not just creating awareness. So I would really push marketers to look past the traditional sales funnel and try to identify what are the 3, 4, 5 other patterns in their customers' kind of lives that they can support. Because I believe that there's going to be tremendous opportunity to deliver service, to deliver product, to capture sales, and ultimately to market and create more long-lasting relationships. So push past the funnel.
All right, thanks, Zach. And another one here for Jared, and it's what do you see as the biggest challenges for businesses in regards to identity?
Sure. Wow, that's a loaded question. I should have bundled up a 30 slide deck to answer that one. But I think part of the hurdle is getting started, just because there have been in the past a lot of challenges in terms of IT and infrastructure. Do I have to re-platform? Do I have to build a new registration system? Do I have to manage social APIs? Do I have to have a new box to store data in that I haven't had previously? And I think that's a great opportunity for us to be having a conversation around why we're in the market we're in today. We find that marketers are the ones driving IT-related decision making in many cases because it impacts their day to day. But the investments and the technologies that are being used need to be designed and need to be friendly for marketers. And that's an area where I think Gigya can help. And I also think one other thing I would add there is, just making that initial leap is not hard. We make it easy to get started. Providing the strategy and the ongoing experience, you're unlocking a lot of new opportunities, a lot of new insight. And that's where experts like Sapient can really provide a lot of value in terms of activating this data and this opportunity that you now have.
Thanks, Jared. A good question here for Zach, which is, how do you convince C-suite execs that spending more on customer experiences proves better ROI?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, it's a question I get every day. For me, it's actually increasingly easy in terms of, I think, the kind of the evidence that we see in terms of the studies like the one done by Watermark. We actually have our own model, our quote-unquote ROX, return experience model, where We talk about the need to both optimize experience and optimize media spend, and how to flatten out kind of the measures across kind of traditional marketing points of view and service and product points of view. So I don't think it's a single silver bullet answer. I think you need to do it by leveraging some of the recent reports that show that companies that are better at experience actually perform better. I think it's about having smaller projects or pilots where people are skeptical and getting really good measurement around them before and after to show that transforming experience actually is a very powerful driver of business. So I'd say, you know, using a multi-pronged approach is probably the best approach, both pulling in secondary outside research and looking for very well articulated and measured before and after case studies within your own organization. And also, if you have problems with that, call me. We'll help you do it too. I mean, I'm serious. Like, I mean, it can be a challenge. Absolutely. Especially in companies where where maybe some of the C-suite does lead a little bit more towards the traditional marketing space. You need to have outsiders help to help bring some proof points to the thinking.
Great, thanks for that, Zach. So I have another question that's addressed for Zach, which is, you know, as marketers and technologists are kind of like, their roles are merging. The question is, do you see it as a technology needs to change to have their viewpoint more towards marketing, or is it marketing that needs to change their viewpoint to technology?
Yeah, it's a killer question, whoever asked that. Great, great question. The reality is, you know, it is both. The fact of the matter is that there's still going to be some differentiation in terms of the focus of individuals, whether they're passionate about technology and that's where their deep skill set lies versus marketing. What we are seeing in the industry, and what other analysts like Forrester and Gartner are saying, is that more and more and more IT budget still under IT, but it starts to become more directly controlled by the CMO or the CPO, the Chief Product Officer, or the CXO, Chief Experience Officer. It doesn't really matter which side gets better at it. What matters is that the kind of thinking, those different perspectives come together to create powerful platforms to create experience. It's not an easy question, actually. We actually, in our company, obviously we care about this passionately as much as anyone in the world, in terms of we like to say the future is story, you know, story meets technology, and that's what we're about. We actually have a program that we've invested massively in the company. We handpicked, let's say, our top 15 or 20 technologists around the world. And we are actually putting them through an executive program called CMTOU. And the notion is, it's Chief Marketing Technology University. And the point of it is that we feel, even we, who we're totally focused on this 100%, need to be even better at blending marketing and technology like never before. So we're taking our best technologists and we're educating them in how to do marketing, how to do storytelling, how to do product and service development. I led actually a module on product and service development and business strategy. So we're actually over investing almost in our technologists to make sure they're incredibly powerful. And that's a program that we're going to continue to invest in. And we're seeing different companies around the world hire roles which might sit below a CMO. And they are the CMTO, the Chief Marketing Technology Officer. And instead of focused on things like ERPs and enterprise stuff, they're focused on exactly the type of thing that, you know, Gigya is trying to enable, and a lot more in terms of all of the considerations that a marketing or the customer-facing activities of a company, their needs in relation to being powered by technology. So I'd say it can come from either. You see some CTOs or CIOs who are remarkably strategic and have massive savvy in marketing, and they can push the business. And sometimes you see marketers forcing that to happen. I don't really care which side it comes from, but definitely the criticality of it cannot be denied.
Great. So we just have one more question, and then if you have any extra questions, you can always email them to Zach, I'm sure, or to info@gigya.com, and we'll have those addressed for you. But just one last question that Zach, that's addressed to Zach, that we'll cover right now. So in the era of cross-channel or omni-channel marketing, how do we determine how customers make trade-offs, and how can firms predict those trade-offs?
That's a very good question.
That's a good one.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's challenging because what we're seeing, obviously, in a massively complex ecosystem is that we have more touch points and more product and kind of choice than ever before. So the notion of attribution and where decisions are made is incredibly difficult. In the most simplistic sense, you know, did the .com help, you know, the store sell another pair of pants? That is a really hard thing to determine. But then when you start thinking about the role of social, the role of, you know, content partners, the role of, it is a very hard question. And I would say there's not a single solution to it. I'd say that there's simple solutions like trying to, again, make sure that your retail teams and your digital teams are working in lockstep and aligning their incentives so that it's less about fighting over attribution. It's more about, you know, creating more of a single pie. Other, you know, things are, you know, platforms like Gigya that where you can maybe start to see where a path across multiple touch points actually led to sales. We also have a capability called IOTA, which is the notion is it comes out of the Internet of Things. And what we do is we instrument people, places, and products. So we actually create instrumentation that we embed in the physical world and on people's digital devices, and we will follow them everywhere. Now, this is an opt-in. Don't think this is something like the NSA where, you know, you don't know about it. This is an opt-in kind of instrumentation. But we've discovered this whole notion of a birth of a sale. Where does it first happen? You know, does it happen when, you know, they're in the store? Does it happen when they first see an ad? Does it happen when you first see, you know, a trend? We're, you know, hell-bent on trying to uncover that. But it's not – that is a really challenging area. So it's a smart question. You know, nice needler question as the last question to kind of throw a hand grenade, you know, in the room. I would say there you know, again, platforms like Gigya, things like making sure retail teams and your digital teams are working very closely together. Things like consumer packaged goods, it gets really difficult. Instrumented communities, again, happy to chat with people about that at some later date if they want to learn about how you can have communities that really you get to know exactly what the behavior is rather than what people tell you it is, even in the physical world. So there's multiple ways you can tackle it, and there is no silver bullet. So hey, fantastic questions, guys, and you know, great opportunity. Thank you for letting me on today. And I'd say if anyone has an additional question, I'd ask you to just tweet it at me at Zachary Paradis. It's easy to find. I'm very easy to find.
Awesome. Yeah, thanks so much, Zach, and thanks everyone for attending. Just a quick note, we will follow up with an email hopefully today with a recorded version of the webinar. So hold tight for that, and thanks everyone for joining. All right, have a good one.
Cheers.